I'm sure over the years, first from Judy Crew and from other folks later, I'm just really pleased that you got to invite me to do the lecture here in Vermont. So, in discussing privacy, it also means discussing things that you sometimes don't always share with people, but I'm going to share a couple things with you tonight. One is that I will take frequent breaks to drink some water. That's because I have a condition called Sjögren's syndrome. It's a rheumatoid condition, and what it does is it affects my moisture-producing glands, which means I have permanent dry mouth, and it's a chronic condition. So if I start sounding a little indistinct, please let me know. I need to take a sip of water, and just be patient as I take frequent sips myself as I go through the thing. And the other thing I thought was really fun and interesting is that I generally bring a cosmetic bag full of my propaganda with me to meetings because I found that it was costing the office something like $40, $50 to ship a box ahead of me, and I fly an airline that ships two bags for free, so I take the bag. So this bag had nothing in it except privacy rights and buttons about maintaining privacy and practical privacy practices. And the TSA decided that they had to go to the bag and take a look. I was just amused. I'm just hoping they took a few things in So you couldn't have a better gift than the headlines for the last 2 weeks. I've been invited to give a privacy talk. And I confess I have not been able to keep completely up with all that's going on in Washington right now with Mr. Zuckerberg's testimony and the various statements being made by various legislators about regulation and no regulation and things like that. But it does point out the fact that surveillance is the business model of the internet. It's behind most of the free services and many of the paid ones as well. The whole goal is to change your behavior through psychological manipulation in the form of personalized advertising or targeted news items that are intended to persuade you to buy something or do something you might not have otherwise thought of doing. Harvard scholar Shoshana Zuboff coined the term surveillance capitalism to describe this form of profit-making. For example, Google offers you free services in exchange for your data. If you think about it, Google surveillance is very intimate. We never lie to our search engines. Our interests, our curiosities, our hopes, our fears, our desires, even our sexual proclivities are typed into that little box, and Google keeps track of all of it. They save it as well. And add that to the websites that we visit that Google tracks through its advertising network, our Gmail accounts, our use of Google Docs, our movements through Google Maps. If you own an Android phone, Google kind of tracks that pretty tightly too, and even just the location on your iPhone. This personal data is all collected, it's analyzed, and then Google uses it. They haven't paid a dime for it, but they use it to sell targeted advertising that then follows you around the internet and tries to change your behavior. Big data, and more precisely big data extraction like this, is a fundamental component of this form of capitalism. There are 2,500 to 4,000 data brokers in the United States and whose sole business is buying and selling our personal data, which of course we've never gotten any compensation for. One such broker, Axiom, had claims to have 1,500 data points on 96% of the population. And this includes things like your shopping habits, your mortgage, your relatives, your pets, your health care, your neighbors, your name, your address, your email, mail, everything. And all this data is packaged and sold to advertisers and others hoping to more precisely target their own users, advertising, fake news, meant to alter our behaviors, consumers, and actors in society. And right now, the increasing number of things equipped with computers is creating a ubiquitous net of sensors and trackers and cameras that they are all creating even more data points about our lives that then can be correlated with our activities both online and off. This includes things like fitness trackers, kitchen appliances, light bulbs, personal assistants like Alexa. This year, we will be listened to, watched, recognized, and recorded by phones, digital assistants, and cameras like never before. Indeed, our smart cell phones are probably the most intimate surveillance device ever invented. It tracks our location continuously, so it knows just where we live, where we work, where we spend our time. It's the first and last thing we check during the day and at night. It knows when we wake up. It knows when we go to sleep. And because, you know, everybody seems to have a smartphone or at least a cell phone with location tracking on it, the phone even knows who we sleep with. Now, this common understanding is that because we get something in return, our free search engines, our social media platforms, our Google Docs, all these apps and tools that we use online for free, we agree to the invasion of privacy represented by the constant network surveillance of online platforms like Google and Facebook. Since the advantages in terms of convenience, safety, and personal connections are so great, we're supposed to be very happy that we are making this trade-off of privacy for convenience. But the fact is, and surveys reveal this, most of the world's internet users lack the information they need to make informed choices. None of us know enough about how our information is collected, shared, retained, and used, and resold, and reused. And the worst of this is that in the United States today, at least most of all of this is completely legal. I will tell you right now that what Facebook did with Cambridge Analytica is 100% legal in the United States. They face far more penalties in Europe and Britain because they have much stricter data privacy regulations there. But we will probably, I know these lawsuits have been filed, but I'll lay money that they're all dismissed before the end of the year because there's no grounds for holding Facebook liable in the United States. So when I was invited to speak with you here today, I was asked to talk about online privacy. And I have a helpful Venn diagram that illustrates the complex interaction between the internet and privacy. Yeah, it's a joke. It's a bit of hyperbole meant to bring home the sad truth. The internet, which we thought would lead to a flowery and freedom and choice of child of the 80s and 90s folks, is primarily a platform for surveillance, operated by corporations and governments that insist that surveillance is a necessary trade-off for security, social connections, and achievement of a fulfilling life. And if anyone raises a concern about the growing ability of corporations, political groups, and the government to track, influence, and manipulate people, well, we're told that we have zero privacy anyway, and we should get over it. Or in the words of Mark Zuckerberg, privacy is no longer a social norm. But if privacy is no longer a social norm, why does Mr. Zuckerberg tape over the camera on his laptop? Why did he buy the houses abutting his property in Palo Alto and tear down all four houses to preserve his privacy? Could it be that Mr. Zuckerberg actually thinks that there's a right to privacy that he should be able to exercise? Yeah, privacy still does exist, and it's essential to who we are as human beings. Privacy gives us the space to be ourselves without judgment, allows us to think freely without discrimination, and is an important element of giving us control over who knows what about us. Privacy creates the conditions that allow us to be individuals. Privacy enables personal autonomy, self-determination. It provides for choice about our beliefs, our work, our companions, and our happiness. But that's a big picture version of privacy. What are we concerned about today, particularly in regards to Facebook and Cambridge Analytica? Alan Weston was a very forward-looking legal scholar. In the 1960s, he proposed this modern definition of privacy at a time when folks were looking back to the old definition of the right to be left alone. He thought, at a time when the first government databases were coming online, UNIVAC, for example, he thought that describing privacy should be described not just as the right to be left alone, but also as the right to determine how much of our personal information is disclosed and to whom, and how it should be maintained, and how it is disseminated. In short, he saw that control over one's personal information is the essential aspect of individual freedom. Freedom can only exist, according to Weston, when you can control who watches or learns about you. The fundamental takeaway is that privacy concerns can exist wherever personally identifiable information or sensitive information is collected, stored, or used. Now, I work for libraries. I work for librarians. I have 52,000 clients, I'm happy to say, who I work for. In the library, we talk about a particular kind of privacy. We're concerned about privacy of the mind in the library, the kind of privacy that protects our ability to keep our intellectual activities and reading habits private and confidential. Protecting this kind of privacy, often called intellectual privacy, means protecting a person from surveillance or interference whenever they're engaged in the act of reading, learning, consulting with their close intimates. It allows us to explore ideas others might not approve of, and figure out for ourselves what our values are in regards to politics, sexuality, and morality, and only share that information when we choose to do it. When librarians create the conditions that give library users the ability to select, access, and use information without fear of embarrassment, judgment, punishment, or ostracism, they enable their patrons to fully realize their freedom to read, explore unorthodox ideas, weigh arguments, fulfill their individual needs, and decide what they believe. This kind of privacy is related to preserving intellectual freedom. Glenn Greenwald observes that even in the absence of actual massive surveillance, just the belief that one is placed under surveillance at any moment is sufficient to trigger self-censorship and can negatively affect one's thoughts, ideas, and creativity, making people more conformist and stifling free expression. And if one doubts that there might be consequences when a person's reading habits come under surveillance, let's consider the plight of the graduate student who was arrested for reading a book on terrorism studies in his own university library. And, by the way, his area of study was terrorism studies. He was, in fact, turned in by a library worker. If you were a student at this university, wouldn't you avoid reading, or at least be seen being reading these kinds of books, no matter what your interest or actual need for that information? And what it comes down to is if a person fears that her activities in the library are being monitored or shared with the public, it's all but certain that she will limit what she does there, avoiding certain books and websites, maybe stop using the library altogether. So, this is George Christian. He's my hero. Way back in 2005, which seems an eon now, and Trina was around with that, working with the Intellectual Freedom Committee at the time, with the support and backing of his board, George chose to challenge the national security letter served on his library consortium by the FBI, simply because he believed that, as a library professional, he had both an ethical and legal obligation to protect his patrons' privacy. At great risk to his own freedom, George ignored the gag order that accompanied the NSL and asked the ACLU to challenge it in court on his behalf. And amazingly, against all odds, he and his board succeeded in keeping his patrons' data safe from government surveillance, mostly because the FBI didn't want his methods revealed, but we'll take a win when we get it. But since then, George has pretty much dedicated his free time to talking about the importance of privacy as a necessary and vital part of intellectual freedom in the library. In a sense, George lives out the ALA Code of Ethics mandate to protect each user's right to privacy and confidentiality. The ALA Code of Ethics, the Library Bill of Rights, and other policy documents adopted by the American Library Association establish a set of professional standards and best practices that provide means to both measure and define the library's policies and practices in regards to user privacy. Laws, whether at the local, state, or federal level, also shape the ways in which the library deals with user information. For example, some state laws, like Vermont's own library privacy statute, codified in 22 BSA 172, dictate that the library records must be kept confidential and not disclosed unless the library is presented with a court order or given permission by the patron. But George is here not only as an example of professionalism, but also because his story represents what's becoming a past era in librarianship, a time when privacy concerns focused almost exclusively on law enforcement's access to library records. Because, you see, when librarians first began to debate privacy and its relationship to free speech, information about patrons flowed in a relatively simple manner. A patron communicated information about herself, her interests and beliefs and values, in the process of borrowing a book or using a reference resource. Book borrowing involved the library creating a paper record and storing it in a circulation record system. And even the introduction of computers in the mid-century didn't change much, since the library kept all its electronic data on its own servers, its tapes, and its disks. So naturally, the concern was keeping the police away from that information unless they had good probable cause to look at it. But over time, the development of networked computing and the internet has caused the library to evolve into a much different, much more complex institution in most instances. These new networks and technologies have led to further advances in library information management systems to manage cataloging, purchasing, and the circulation of library books. Eventually, database services would develop and become essential to institutional operations as well. Today, I rate the majority of library information systems are commercially run by vendors and who store the data in the cloud, that amorphous thing that we are told is out there somewhere with all our information in it. And libraries no longer control the servers or the data in those systems. Libraries now function as digital consumers, relying on third-party vendors. But in this era, libraries are also digital providers. In that role, libraries generate all kinds of patron data. For example, in one instance, they hold patron computer reservation data because computer reservation systems require you to input your patron ID and all the information that's associated with it. Libraries also hold internet traffic data, collected by the network management tools that are used to help the administrators manage network performance and bandwidth usage. And if your library has an internet filter on, there's even more monitoring of what's going on in that. And now that information is about data use, patron use of the data of the internet, and stored away on blogs and servers somewhere. Now, in their role as digital dependents, libraries contract services with third-party vendors who in turn generate new kinds of patron data and make it even harder to defend patron privacy. For example, services ranging from chat reference to periodical databases to social tools in the online catalog, excuse me while I shudder, must capture patron information in order to function. Searching, retrieving, and reading occurs online via digital tools, databases, and readers that are able to track reader habits and reader preferences both within and without the library. This raises the possibility for security and other privacy risks, such as the use of patron data by third parties in ways that patrons might not suspect or even desire. We can consider the infamous case of Adobe Digital Editions. By mere chance, a software engineer, and happened to be the spouse of a librarian, discovered that the ebook platform was gathering data on patron use of ebooks and then sending that data back in unencrypted clear text to Adobe servers, accompanied by the user ID and the metadata associated with the book. While Adobe took immediate steps to encrypt its data flows and limited the collection of metadata in the future to ebooks that had digital rights management, i.e. there was a contract to collect that information, it illustrates how vendors can be careless with patron data. Of course, it also begs the question about whether Adobe has any right at all to collect data about a patron's reading habits. But we have to be sensitive to this collection because we want to be able to lend and borrow ebooks, and we can't do it without agreeing to Adobe's terms of service. Now, third-party management of patron data also raises the question about how this data can be protected from government surveillance. Our old friend Skinner up there, he's been in my slideshows now for, 15 years now. Some Skunkwin actors are very able to reach beyond the library and request patron data from vendors who don't share a librarian's ethical commitment to protecting patron privacy, don't have a legal obligation to protect that information, and may have much more lax and lenient rules about sharing data with the police. And the library's reliance on networks and online transactions means that those transactions are subject to the NSA surveillance dragnet, which collects and stores nearly 1.7 emails, phone calls, and other online communications each day. And finally, there's now platforms and tools that will match a patron's address to consumer data profiles generated by the credit bureaus. And this is done for the purpose of marketing and data analysis by libraries. The pitch goes like this. Curious about whether households in your community would read a library mailing? Individuals with a history of mail order buying are twice as likely to respond to a promotion as someone who has never purchased by mail. Our app contains more details around households who have purchased merchandise, magazines, or services by mail, or have responded with contributions to charitable or nonprofit appeals. So therefore, you library want to marry your patron data to our database so you can market to those persons. And these platforms are actually proliferating, and if you really look into them, I've gotten calls from libraries frightened about what they've seen in these marketing and the promotion of these platforms. And it's needless to say, collecting user data for marketing and analysis purposes rather than for improving library services, which is the usual reason you collect patron data, represents a major move away from core library values concerning privacy and data management. Now, this is a matter of debate within the profession. Peter Brantley, formerly a librarian at the New York Public Library, who is now director of online strategy at the University of California at Davis, supports the use of patron data, and he says libraries must begin to collect and use patron data to develop better, more personalized services or risk becoming irrelevant. And I quote, and he says, clinging to an ideal of a public library as an assured safe haven does a disservice both to our users and to our libraries. In today's digital world, libraries cannot guarantee the absolute privacy of our users. But more importantly, for our own purposes, we shouldn't want to. He goes on to argue that library user data can be useful in the development of high-quality services, that libraries already collect identifiable user data and enable third parties to collect and use that data, and that patrons should just accept that web-based library services require that they lower their expectations of privacy in order to obtain those services. But missing from this discussion is the library patron. Librarian and researcher Bonnie Tijerina observes, no one who goes to the library to borrow a book or surf the web does so to have their personal information collected and shared with a third party, even one that you might regard as benign, like maybe your drive, maybe. If we mean what we say about defending a patron's privacy, we must not only keep their information safe from disclosure, but also let the patron choose what happens to it. It's important to remember that, just as many public opinion surveys say, that the public library is considered one of the few trusted entities in our society, a place where people can learn, search, and read with their privacy rights intact. Now, given this unique role of libraries within their communities, it's imperative that libraries and librarians make patron privacy a priority when considering the adoption of new services and tools. Thus, we should not only keep information private on the patron's behalf, we should also provide them with sufficient information and access so they can exercise meaningful control over their information about library use. So what would this look like as a matter of library policy and practice? It would require the library to adopt and use the Fair Information Practice Principles, such as transparency, informed user consent, data minimization, and limits on data use. And when possible, provide patrons access to tools and procedures that allow for anonymous use services and data storage, and opting in for the highest level of security provided by a library vendor. It would also require libraries to enter into contracts with vendors that oblige them to encrypt those data flows, acknowledge the library's ownership of the data, and refuse to allow them to use the data for any purpose other than the one that the library allows, and also to adhere to the library's privacy policies and ethics in regards to privacy. Now, I've encapsulated this into five steps to better digital privacy in the library. And essentially, you have to start with your policies. Examine, evaluate, and update your policies. This includes providing robust support for informed consent. That is, providing users with all available information about a platform or a service's use of patron data. And so that they can make meaningful choices about what information they want to share and how they want that data treated. This is especially important given that so many public library patrons have no alternatives to turn to for safe, private access to books, information, and the internet. Political activists, members of the LGBT community, immigrants, domestic abuse victims, persons with substance health issues, students and children who will be taxpaying adults someday, all of them entrust their personal information with their reading habits to the library. We need to remember this as we make decisions about what to collect, what to retain, and what to share of library users' records and information. Second thing is encryption. Employ full encryption for library websites, native services, and data storage, and opt in for the highest level of security that you can get from your services, that you can install on your servers, whatever. By adopting comprehensive encryption strategies, you can close a major privacy vulnerability, especially in regards to online catalogs, content platforms, and discovery services. Also, encrypt your stored data, including data that is archived off-site or in the cloud. And now, you provide data to a vendor providing e-content like books, or providing catalog or data management services to the library. The library should require the vendor to enter into a legal agreement with the library that stipulates the library does retain control of the user data, that the data is confidential, and that it can't be used for anything other than what the library has collected it for. And finally, when negotiating contracts for vendor provided content and services, they should also be required to use the same encryption that the library is using, and notify the library when a data breach occurs immediately, not 6 months down the road. Also, provide patrons with the means to protect their own privacy. This means on public access computers, going beyond the standard practice of equipping a station with deep freeze, for example, that wipes out browsing history and files that may have been put on the computer by the patron. This means allowing them to use tools like Privacy Badger, Tor browsers, and alternative search engines like DuckDuckGo that allow for the anonymous use of the internet. Allowing them to use robust encryption tools that you can carry in your pocket on a thumb drive is nothing but good for both you and the patron. And finally, most importantly, you need a program of ongoing privacy education and training for staff and users alike. Patron privacy is not just a matter of policies or vendor negotiations or network security. It relies on trained and committed staff, all staff members, professionals, paraprofessionals, support staff alike, should be given training opportunities that inform them about the library's privacy policies, inform them about the library's obligation to protect that privacy, and their own ethical and legal obligations. Frontline staff should also have additional training. They should be trained in how to talk to patrons about protecting their own privacy, teaching them how to use Privacy Badger, for example, so they can then give that information to the patron. So before I stop to take questions and comments, I want to circle back to the library ethics and its association with patron privacy. I'm often